the bloody theater or martyr's mirror of the defenseless Christians who baptized only upon confession of faith and who suffered and died for the testimony of Jesus, their Savior, from the time of Christ to the year A.D. 1660. An account of the pious martyrs and witnesses of Jesus Christ who suffered during the first century, that is, from the death of Christ to the year A.D. 100. Summary of the martyrs of the first century. This first century did not pass without the shedding of much blood of the saints, for since Jesus Christ himself, the leader of all true believers, was subject to it, it was just that his members should follow in the same path. Yet John died before Christ, but after the death of Christ, the fire of persecution raged exceedingly, consuming nearly all of the beloved apostles and friends of Christ according to the flesh. We have described those who followed Christ, their captain, into suffering and death, according to the order of time. They are the following persons: Stephen, the deacon, the apostles, James, Philip, Barnabas, Mark the evangelist, Peter, Paul, some companions and friends of Paul, as Aristarchus, Epaphras, Silas, Onesiphorus, Prochorus, Nicanor, Parmenas, Olympus, Carpus, Trophimus, Martyrus, Aegidus, Hermagoras, Onesimus, Dionysius of Athens, and Timothy. But the latter was slain a few years after the others. In the meantime, the preceding ones are followed by the apostles Andrew, Bartholomew, Thomas, Matthew, Simon, Zelotes, Matthias, Luke the evangelist, Antipas, the faithful martyr of Jesus, John, whom Jesus loved, Ertachinus, Vitalis, and so on, all of whom obtained the martyr's crown, as may be seen from the following account. To Jesus Christ, the Son of God, we have accorded the first place among the martyrs of the New Covenant, not in the order of time, for herein John was before and preceded with his death, but on account of the worthiness of the person, because he is the head of all the holy martyrs, through whom they all must be saved. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, crucified at Jerusalem. About 3,970 years after the creation of the world, in the 42nd year of the reign of Augustus, the second Roman emperor, when the whole world was at peace, Jesus Christ was born of the Virgin Mary in the little town of Bethlehem, being the only and eternal Son of God, the Word which by all things are made, yea, God blessed forever, Matthew 16:16, John 1:14, Romans 9:5. But his entrance into this world, as well as his progress and end, was full of misery, distress, and affliction. Indeed, it may be said, he was born under the cross, brought up under the cross, he walked under the cross, and finally died on the cross. Touching his birth, he was conceived of the Holy Ghost. His birth ushered him into great poverty, for he was not born in his maternal city Nazareth, but on the journey to Bethlehem, which was a cause that no suitable place could be prepared for his birth. Yea, even more, he could obtain no place in the inn, but had to be born in a stable. And when he was born, he was wrapped in swaddling clothes and laid in a manger. Touching his bringing up, it was attended with much sorrow, for when he was still less than 2 years old, Herod persecuted him even unto death, on account of which his foster father Joseph and his mother Mary had to flee into Egypt and remain there until Herod's death. But meanwhile there were killed in his stead, that he also might be killed, all the children of 2 years and under, in and about Bethlehem, so that the voice of lamentation was heard in all the boundaries of that region, of which Jeremiah had prophesied. A voice was heard in Ramah, lamentation and bitter weeping. Rachel, weeping for her children, refused to be comforted for her children, because they were not. Jeremiah 31:15, fulfilled Matthew 2:18. As regards his life and conversation among men, he was considered an enthusiast and vagrant, because he had no permanent place of abode, which latter was nevertheless thus bitter for him, that he complains, "Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head." Luke 9:58. Meanwhile, he was reproached as being a friend of publicans and sinners, a glutton and wine-bibber, yea, that he was possessed with the devil, and this until the hour of his departure was nigh at hand. Concerning the end of his life, it was the most miserable, for it was, so to speak, the day when all the fountains of the great deep broke forth over him, and the floods of suffering overflowed him, to swallow him up altogether. First of all, he was betrayed by his disciple Judas, who sold him for 30 pieces of silver to the high priests and Pharisees, Matthew 26:14-16. Then he was delivered unto them, sharply examined, yea, adjured by the living God, to say whether he was a Christ, the Son of God. And as soon as the Lord had confessed this, they cried, "He is guilty of death." Then they spit in his face and buffeted him. Others covered his face, saying, "Prophesy unto us, thou Christ, who is he that smote thee?" Matthew 27:67-68. This having continued till about morning, they delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the judge, to pronounce the sentence of death upon him, and to put an end to his life. Matthew 27:1-2. Pilate said, "What accusations bring ye against this man?" They answered, "If he were not a malefactor, we would not have delivered him up unto thee." Pilate said, "Take ye him, and judge him according to your law." For he perceived that for envy they had delivered him. They answered, "He perverts the nation, and forbids to give tribute to Caesar, saying that he himself is a king. In short, we have a law, and by our law he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God." John 19:7. Thereupon Pilate took Jesus into the judgment hall, and having examined him, said that he found no cause of death in him. Therefore he sought a means to release him. Moreover, in order to move the Jews to pity on account of his innocence, he caused him, though against his conscience, to be terribly scourged, crowned with thorns, mocked, and thus disfigured, brought before the Jews, saying, "Behold the man," so that they might now be satisfied with his suffering and spare his life. But it was of no avail. They cried the more, "Crucify him, crucify him. If thou let this man go, thou art not Caesar's friend." Verse 12. Finally, when Pilate saw that the Jews were not to be moved, and fearing that they might accuse him before Caesar, he went and sat down at about 8 o'clock in the morning, according to our reckoning, in the judgment seat, in the place called Lithostratus, and in Hebrew, Gibeda, a paved elevation in Jerusalem, and there, though quite against his conscience, pronounced the sentence of death upon Christ. Thereupon the soldiers again very dreadfully mocked him, laid his cross upon him, and drove him out through the gate up to Mount Calvary, where they, after having stripped him of his garments, nailed him to a cross, and raised him up between two murderers, John 19:18, which was done, according to our reckoning, at about 9 o'clock in the morning. In the meantime, they gave him vinegar and gall to drink, parted his garments, and again derided him most shamefully and above measure, till a great darkness came, continuing for about 3 hours. And then the Lord cried with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?" That is, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Matthew 27:46. Then, having fulfilled all, he commended his soul into his Father's hands, saying, "Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit." Luke 23:46. Thereupon he bowed his head and expired, having suffered excruciatingly 6 hours on the cross, from 9 o'clock in the morning till 3 in the afternoon. Then the earth began to quake, and rocks were rent, and graves were opened. the veil of the temple was rent in twain, and many miracles happened as a sign that he who died there was more than a common man, yea, that he was the Son of the living God. This then was the end, not of a martyr, but of the head of all the holy martyrs, through whom they and we all must be saved.